NBA history is filled with countless what-ifs. What if Derrick Rose never suffered such a horrible knee injury? What if LeBron had chosen to sign with the Bulls rather than the Heat? What if all-time greats like Steve Nash or Carmelo Anthony just had one other piece on their team that brought them to a championship and changed their legacy forever? What if Giannis or Embiid were drafted by a different team? How would their careers turn out differently? These are all questions that will be answered in this video series as I re-simulate the NBA from the 09-10 season up until the current year as we watch together as history writes itself. If you would like to watch me do this live, go to my Twitch channel at twitch.tv/bigbird4. The link is at the top of the description. For this series, I recreated the entire 09-10 roster from stars to benchwarmers to free agents. I calibrated for every single factor for each player, including ratings, contracts, their player growth potential, and even appearance. If you want to get a more in-depth look at the roster I made, here's a video I made on that where I go through each team and show you all the players I included. In the 09-10 season, the Nuggets beat out the favorite Lakers to make it to the finals, but they destroyed the Sixers in 5 games. During the offseason, both finals teams significantly improved their teams, as Denver signed Chris Bosh in free agency, and Philadelphia signs Dwayne Wade. The Jazz are able to snag LeBron, and Rondo signs with the Hawks. In the 10-11 season, the Nuggets and Sixers again faced each other in the finals, and this series was a lot closer than last year. However, in overtime in Game 6, the Nuggets are able to pull off another victory, and Carmelo wins back-to-back finals MVPs. To start off the offseason, Jason Kidd, Antonio McDyess, and Michael Finley all retire after illustrious careers, but are named to the Hall of Fame. The Trailblazers get the number one pick for the second year in a row, and with it they pick another point guard in Kyrie Irving. Kawhi Leonard goes to the Pistons with the second pick, and Kemba goes to the Raptors in third. Klay Thompson is drafted by the Pacers with the fourth pick, and Jimmy Butler drops to the ninth pick and goes to the New Jersey Nets. The Nuggets, despite having the 30th pick, find a steal in Tobias Harris, and only add to their dominating team. While not as stacked as last year, this offseason still has a lot of great players available in free agency.
We got Chris Paul, Tony Parker, Kevin Durant, Amari Stoudemire, Caron Butler, Al Horford, Carlos Boozer, oh, he's still injured, Mike Conley, David West. That's actually a very solid free agency class.
Instead of going through where each player went, I want to go over the most impactful signings of the offseason. To start off, the Sixers team remains mostly the same, except for the loss of Thaddeus Young. The Hawks lose Horford, but sign Nene. Behind Rondo and Joe Johnson, they're still looking to make a splash in the postseason. The Jazz lose Boozer to the Trailblazers, but sign Troy Murphy in playoff red, and are still looking to be contenders. The Nuggets sign Yao Ming, who may not be at his peak anymore, but he's still a solid defensive replacement for Nene. The Spurs lose Tony Parker to the Heat, but sign Chris Paul as their replacement, as well as an aging Shaq. The Thunder lose Kevin Durant, and he decides to repeat history just a few years sooner, and he joins Curry in San Francisco, bringing their team into contention for the title. To start the season off, the Sixers don't disappoint and are first in the East after 20 games. The Magic are a close second, followed by the Bobcats and Bulls, two young teams who are exceeding expectations. In the West, the Warriors are at the top of the standing, followed by the Spurs, who are on a great run behind their new point guard, Chris Paul. The Suns also shock the NBA world and are in third place, as Dragic is having a breakout year averaging 23 points a game. The All-Star game had quite a few surprises, and a lot of first-time selections in Ty Lawson, DeMarcus Cousins, Blake Griffin, and Nene. Danny Granger makes his first All-Star starter selection, and Paul Pierce and Garnett are still able to make it, despite their old age. Carmelo didn't make the team. However, that was due to him getting injured just a few games before the selections. Steph Curry was also snubbed, despite averaging 27-8, and his team being at the top of the league. The All-Star game this year was a tight race. With a minute left, Kobe finds Paul open for a three, and he drills it, bringing the West up by one. Wade responds the next play with a fadeaway in the paint, but Chris Paul comes back again and converts on an and-one. Durant slams in a dunk on the fast break, and it looks like things are over in this game. However, Wade decides to go for a 2-for-1 and chucks a fadeaway from 3 and drills it, bringing the East within 1. The West takes it back up, and Durant responds with his own fadeaway inside the line, making it a three-point game. Wade drives in and tries to get an and-one, but narrowly misses the layup. He still hits his free throws, and then fouls Kobe. Kobe misses his first shot at the line, but hits the second, and it's a two-point game with 20 seconds to go. The East run up the floor, but can't seem to run a play, and Rose misses the game-winning shot. The All-Star MVP goes to Chris Bosh, who scored 32 points. Kevin Durant wins the MVP after leading the Warriors to the first seed in the West with his running mate Steph Curry. Kawhi Leonard wins Rookie of the Year, and LeBron wins Defensive Player of the Year for a second time in his career, leading the Jazz to the third seed. Dragic unsurprisingly wins MIP and helps the Suns reach the seventh seed. The biggest surprise for the All-NBA team selections was Nikola Vucevic, who made the third team as a rookie despite not winning Rookie of the Year.
The first matchup in the West was the Warriors and Blazers. The Warriors were the clear favorites behind KD and Steph, but the Blazers were far from a bad team. They had sophomore John Wall, who was emerging as a star, as well as the sixth man of the year and rookie Kyrie Irving. Carlos Boozer also made the All-Star team, and with those three combined with some great players like Rudy Fernandez and Batum, they were expected to give Golden State a run for their money. Despite their potential, Portland fumbled the bag and were down 3-0 to start the series as Curry went off. Durant, however, was caught slacking, and averaged less than 20 points for the series. The poor performances from Durant would catch the Warriors in Game 4 and 5, as the Blazers won them both with narrow victories. While the Warriors blew them out in Game 6, Durant again only scored 21 points, and the Warriors' title run was looking a bit iffy. The next series was the Thunder and Spurs. Chris Paul, the best and only good player in the Spurs, was injured, and Westbrook and Harden took full advantage. They blew the Spurs out in Game 1 and 2, and while Paul came back for Game 3, his effort wasn't enough, and the Thunder swept San Antonio in 4 games. The next series was the matchup everyone was waiting for, but no one expected it to happen in the first round at the start of the season. The third seed Jazz was going up against the Nuggets, who had missed Melo for a third of the season, and therefore fallen to the sixth seed. Melo was back and healthy for the playoffs, however, and this rematch was what every NBA fan was waiting for this whole year. The Jazz took Game 1 behind a 30-point triple-double by LeBron, but the whole Nuggets team came out to play in Game 2. As Lawson, Bosch, and Melo all had 20-point double-doubles. The Jazz won the next two, but the Nuggets kept things competitive and won Game 5. It all came down to Game 6. LeBron was the only superstar from the 2003 draft class to not win a ring, and by golly, this year was going to be his year. While close at times, the Jazz never let up, and pulled off a close victory in Game 6, and would advance to the next round. The 2nd seed Lakers and the 7th seed Suns were up next, and there was some serious beef between these teams. In the previous season, the Lakers had some injury troubles and were narrowly beat out by the Suns in the playoff race. This was only the third time since 1983 that the Lakers had missed the playoffs, and they were ready to get their revenge on the young Suns team. Game 1 was looking really close, but after Kobe slammed in this absolutely ferocious dunk, it was over, and the Lakers got the victory. Game 2 was another nail-biter, as Lowry went off and ended the game with 26 points, 16 rebounds, and 18 assists, narrowly beating out the Lakers by 2. Game 3 was another close one, but Kobe again sealed the deal with a monster jam. After that, the Lakers dismantled the Phoenix's defense and won the series in 5. In the East, the first matchup was the 1st seed 76ers and the 8th seed Charlotte Bobcats. While Philly was obviously the favorite, the Bobcats had a great team with the star duo of Paul George and Dirk Nowitzki. The Bobcats beat all the odds and swept the Sixers in their first 3 games. They came back in Game 4 and 5, but that wasn't enough, as the 8th seed Bobcats advanced to the second round. The next matchup is the 4th seed Bulls and the 5th seed Pacers. The Bulls had a great season with Derrick Rose leading the charge. However, with just a few games left in the season, he broke his back and was out for the rest of the season. LaMarcus Aldridge also broke multiple fingers in his right hand and was only playing limited minutes. The Pacers were expected to sweep, as they had Steve Nash, Danny Granger, and breakout rookie Klay Thompson, as well as an emerging potential star in Roy Hibbert at center. Despite all of Indiana's firepower, the Bulls are able to take advantage of playing at home the first 2 games, and won both, with Taj Gibson and Jordan Crawford leading the charge. Game 3 was a close one, as they were tied at 1-3 with 40 seconds left. Hibbert was able to find Klay open in the corner, and he lays it in off the drive, taking the lead for the Pacers. Aldridge isn't able to score with a hand in his face on the other end, and Indiana runs up in transition, dishing it to Klay in the corner who knocks it down, and finishes the night with 33 points. While the Pacers squeaked by with a win this game,
they got swept in the next two and the Bulls advance. The 13 Magic faced up against the 6-seed Wizards. Both teams had the same core as last year and were both potential contenders. Orlando still had Howard in the post, as good as ever, but the only significant player they added since their team since 09 was Danny Green, and he was little more than a good starter. The Wizards also had an aging problem, as their stars were all well into their 30s. Arenas was dropping quick, Duncan wasn't nearly as fast as he used to be, and Jameson looked to be ready to retire. The series ended up being somewhat close, but the Magic won in 6. There isn't much to say about the last matchup between the Hawks and Knicks. For the third straight year, the Knicks had made no changes to their team and were still somehow making it to the playoffs every year behind David Lee and Lil Nate. And, as always, they got swept in the first round, as Jeff Teague goes into superstar mode, as he averages nearly 30-10 to kick New York out. In the West, Durant would face off against his former teammates Westbrook and Harden. There's a lot of bad blood between them, as all three saw themselves as alphas and were ready to prove their worth. Game 1 was a bloodbath, but OKC managed to come out on top, winning 96-92 behind Westbrook's 29 points. The Warriors won the next three games by pretty wide margins. Game 5 was a must-win for the Thunder. With 40 seconds left, Curry finds Budrins wide open next to the basket, and he lays it in. Westbrook tries to respond from mid, but misses, and the Warriors come back on a fast break. They find Durant posted up in the paint, but he misses the open lay-in to tie the game. The Warriors are forced to foul Harden. He knocks down both his free throws, keeping the Thunder alive for another game. Turns out Game 5 was the catalyst that Oklahoma City needed, as Westbrook scores over 40 in the next two games and wins the series. The next matchup was the Lakers and Jazz, and this was expected to be a cakewalk for LeBron, and that's exactly what it looked like in the first three games as the Jazz won all three. But Kobe didn't make things easy for them in Game 4, as the Lakers are up by 4 with under a minute to go. LeBron freight trains his way into the paint and makes it a one-possession game. Kobe takes it the other way and drives off the screen from Powell and finishes with the defense all over him. The Jazz find Millsap wide open off the timeout, but he misses the jumper, and the Lakers take a game. Game 5 is another close one, as the Lakers are down by 3 with 40 seconds to go. Dudley is able to find Kobe open from close range, and he sinks the shot. Red finds himself open for 3 on the other end but bricks it, giving the Lakers a chance to take the lead. And as you well know, Kobe never backs down from big moments. And with ice in his veins, he finishes in the paint, draped by the defense. This leaves the Jazz 14 seconds to win the game. The play they planned to run fell through, but Williams is still able to find Red in the paint. He puts up the shot, but it rolls off the rim, and the Lakers win another one. Would the Lakers be able to be the first team in playoff history to come back from a 3-0? Unfortunately, it wasn't meant to be, and Utah blows them out by 40 in Game 6, as they'll go on to face the Thunder in the Conference Finals. In the East, the first matchup is not the one that many expected, as the 8th-seed Bobcats faced up against the Roseless Bulls. Aldridge was still playing limited minutes, and wasn't the same shooter with his broken fingers, but this didn't seem to affect the Bulls in their first two games, as they won them both. Game 3 looked like it was going to be a blow as the Bobcats were up by 25 in the first half, but Rand Felton breaks his leg in the third quarter, and the Bulls are able to narrow the gap to 4 with just a minute left. However, Charlotte's still able to squeeze by with the victory. The Bulls win in Game 4 behind Heinrich's 19 points, but the Bobcats come back in the next two, and we are going to have our second Game 7 of the second round. The game is tied at 85 with just a minute left, as Heinrich finds Aldridge in the paint and he slams it in. The Bobcats can't buy a bucket, and Aldridge comes in clutch again, this time hitting a fadeaway from the free throw line, and puts the Bulls up by 4 with only 20 seconds to go. George misses a 3 after a few failed pump fakes, and the Bulls will advance to the Conference Finals. The Hawks and Magic proved to be a great matchup, as Game 1 was a tight race between Howard and Teague going back and forth. The Hawks were up by 5 with just 40 seconds to go, but Jameer Nelson hits a moving jumper to pull Orlando within 3. Rondo misses a jumper on the other end, and Carter goes ISO mode to make it just a one possession game. The Magic managed to get the Hawks to inbound it to Rondo, who misses a free throw, and it's just a 2-point game with 7 seconds to go. The Magic get it into Carter, who drives straight for the hoop and gets fouled. He knocks down both his free throws, and this gives Atlanta 5 seconds to score. Rondo can't get it up the floor in time and has to chuck it, narrowly missing. In overtime, the Hawks find themselves up by 5 yet again with just a minute to go, but Jameer is able to find Howard cutting, and he slams it in. The next play, Carter misses a fadeaway, but Howard snatches the rebound and gets fouled, and will go to the line.
Dwight comes in clutch and hits both his free throws. The Magic again manage to get Atlanta to inbound into Rondo, but this time he knocks down both, pulling the Hawks ahead by three. The Magic call a timeout and find Danny Green open for three, and he drills it. Atlanta calls a timeout, and Rondo finds Nene wide open at the rim, but he misses. Vince Carter takes the other way, but also misses by the hoop. This gives the Hawks one last chance, and they decide to go with their playoff god, Jeff Teague. He drives in towards the rim, and Howard stuffs it, taking them into a double overtime. The Hawks find themselves up by three with 30 seconds to go, but Josh Smith can't score a shot to save his life. Nene grabs the rebound and goes back up, despite there being less than 24 seconds to go. Gortat snatches it out of his hands and passes the ball up. Duhon fails to lay it in, but Carter again comes in clutch and tips it in, pulling the Magic to be just a point behind. They foul Jeff Teague and he scores his free throws, pulling the Hawks' lead up to three with only 9 seconds left. They call a timeout and draw a play for Jameer Nelson to take the three, and he drills it, tying the game up. The Hawks call a timeout and have 7 seconds to win this game. Nene tries to inbound it, but ends up in Duhon's hands. He passes it up court and finds Jameer Nelson again, who finger rolls it in, giving the Magic the lead. The Hawks have 0.9 seconds to score. They pass it into Nene, who gets it up in time, but it's no good, and the Magic take game one. Unfortunately for the Hawks, this is the beginning of the end, and the Magic sweep them in 5 games. There was a lot riding on these conference finals. This was LeBron's 4th straight conference final appearance, and he was fed up with not making as far as he'd hoped. While he had already defeated his main competition, the Denver Nuggets, this Thunder team was no joke. They had already defeated the favorites in the Warriors, and had a much younger core that was full of steam. Game 1 was neck and neck, and the Thunder had the lead with 40 seconds to go. Utah had possession, as LeBron drives into the lane. He jumps in the air, and has one of the greatest dunks in playoff history, as he slams it down in Westbrook's face and also gets the foul. Westbrook is never going to live this moment down. LeBron scores his free throw, and Westbrook takes the ball up the court. He tries to make up for what just happened to him by pulling up from mid-range, but bricks it, and the Jazz come the other way on a fast break. They find Williams open in the paint, but he gets fouled hard by Westbrook, who's still brooding about getting postered. Williams knocks down both his free throws, and Oklahoma calls timeout. They pass it into Harden, who quickly passes it off to Westbrook. He tries to drive in the lane, but gets stopped, and decides to pass it off to Cole Aldrich. Big mistake. Aldridge tries to lay it in but misses, and Michael Redd seals the deal on the other end with 2 free throws. You would think that the Thunder were going to get swept after what happened to them in the previous game, but game 2 is just as close. This time the Jazz were up by 3 with a minute to go. Westbrook finds Ibaka in the paint, but he gets fouled as he takes it up and he'll shoot 2. Ibaka was a bit of a streaky free throw shooter, and he really streaked out this time, missing not one but both of his free throw attempts. Ibaka makes it up on the other end, however, as he catches Murphy's dunk attempt mid-air, causing a Thunder fast break, with Aldridge finishing on the other end of the floor. LeBron takes it back up, guarded by Chris Singleton. Ibaka comes over for the double, and James passes it off to Millsap for the wide-open layup. The Thunder inbound it to Westbrook, who finds Ibaka wide open by the rim, and throws it to him for a two-handed dunk. Oklahoma fouls Deron Williams, and he knocks down both his free throws, making it a 3-point game. They inbound it to Harden, who throws it up to Singleton. I'm not sure what got into him, but Singleton freaks out and just chucks it up, missing the shot. Ibaka is able to grab the rebound and passes it back to Singleton, who throws it up once more, again breaking it, and the Thunder are now down 2 games. OKC was really showing their age in the first 2 games, making knucklehead decisions in the closing minutes. But in game 3, they still managed to keep things close, and were up by 1 with just a few minutes to go. Westbrook drives and pulls up from the elbow, and makes it a 3-point game. Williams, who just scored 2 threes previously and was feeling hot, decides to go for a fadeaway from 30 feet, and obviously bricks it. Harden comes back the other way and hits a similar shot from 2-point range. The Jazz come back from a timeout looking for a quick bucket, and playoff Red delivers with a drive to the rim. Unfortunately, it wasn't enough, and the Thunder secure a win after Harden scores his free throws, and Williams misses another 3. Game 4 was a bit of a mess for LeBron and D-Will, but luckily Troy Murphy was there to cut them some slack, and ended the game with 27-9, and leading the Jazz to victory. Harden responded the next game with 44-11, and crushed the Jazz by 20. Game 6 was a live or die for the Thunder, and they fought hard the whole game, and were down by just 1 with 40 seconds to go. LeBron finds himself open for a long 2, and drops it in. Westbrook comes back the other way, and does what he does best, tries a running fadeaway from three and nearly airballs it. On the other end, LeBron gets doubled and passes off to Eric Maynor, who is wide open at the three-point line, and he drills it, sealing the deal. And just like that, the Utah Jazz were going to the NBA Finals. Unfortunately, the Eastern Conference Finals weren't nearly as eventful. Despite Aldridge making a full recovery, they didn't have anyone on defense to stop Dwight Howard, and lost in just four games. And with that, Dwight Howard would be making his second Finals appearance in 4 years. This NBA Finals was groundbreaking, and for multiple reasons. First, neither team had ever won a championship in their team's entire existence. In fact, they had both only been in the Finals twice, and neither team was planning on losing. This was also LeBron and Dwight Howard's second Finals appearance, as they had both been swept in previous years. The odds were in the Jazz's favor, but the only stopper they had for Dwight was Paul Millsap, and he's a little undersized. The Jazz were able to take the first two games with ease on their home court. But things went differently down in Orlando. Howard put up a clinic and scored over 30 points with 20 rebounds in both games, tying the series at 2 apiece. Back in Utah, LeBron had a 26-point triple-double alongside 7 steals, demonstrating why he was named Defensive Player of the Year, and gave Utah the lead. I wish I could say Game 6 was a close one, and Orlando held on and put up a fight, but the Jazz dominated yet again. LeBron finally brought Utah their first championship. Something that Karl Malone and John Stockton fought to do in 18 years, LeBron did in 2. To be fair, he didn't have to face Michael Jordan, but it was still an impressive feat. LeBron wins his first ever Finals MVP, and in a way, the series mimics real life, as LeBron won his first championship ever in 2012, in his second year with the Heat. So what's in store for next season? Will LeBron do what he did in real life and win multiple championships? Or will the Thunder get the best of them next year? Or perhaps the Warriors, who exited much earlier this season than they would have liked to. Find out in the next installment, or go follow me on Twitch at twitch.tv/bigbird4. I stream all of these seasons live, and we go into a lot more depth on stream. I also give a lot of freedom to viewers to watch whatever they want, so turn on notifications so you can know when I'm streaming next. Well, that's gonna do it for this video, so thank you for sticking around, but I'll see you again in the 2013-2014 season.